Welcome back to my free beginner course, students. In this lesson, I'm going to teach you Wolfart's Etude number 9, and it's very beautiful and melodic. It's in D major, but because it also has two sharps just as a B minor, it's good to prepare you for the reading concerto we're going to learn next week. Now, if you're thinking, what is this beginner course all about? Well, it's a free course here on YouTube, and you can see all the lessons right here, and it takes you from scratch up to playing your first and, yeah, as of next week, your second concerto. So you can follow all those lessons in that playlist. If you have no idea who I am, I'm Zlata, I live in Holland, and I'm a professional violinist turned stay-at-home mom and now sharing my art and skills online. Now, in this video, I'm going to give you a performance, a slow play-along, and also a tutorial for this etude. Here is the performance. Here is the slow play-along version. The whole Wolfart book as a free download for you over at violinlessonsforfree.com, and there I will keep you up to date with all resources that you require to follow along with this course. If you're thinking, hey, that's fun, a piano accompaniment to my etude, making it a lot less boring, and also teaching you to play together and to put this etude more in a musical context, then the app I'm using here is called TomPlay, and I would like to offer you a 14-day free trial if you use my link in the description of this video, and after that you can use my coupon code, and I recommend using it right away so it automatically goes on after that 14 days with that discount of 30%. I use this app myself to prepare for rehearsals with my pianist, and I recommend it to violinists of all levels to enhance your practice sessions and to get faster progress, because you can play those accompaniments at any speed. You can also play them together with the violin part, so you can play along, and you know, you can use a metronome and, you know, everything. Now, here are some practice tips for this etude, and actually this etude is maybe a bit more challenging than the concerto that we're about to play. So even if you don't get it up to tempo, and even if you're fumbling around with it a little bit, then you're still learning from it, okay? What I recommend is to ignore the bowings in the first place and just focus on getting the notes right and in tune. So play it through very slowly. something like that. And repeat every note as many times as you like until you really get it in tune. And some ways to check if you're in tune is to use, for example, a D'Addario micro tuner, which is really useful. I'll link to it somewhere in the description or to my review video of that. And if you got all these notes right, then you move to slurring them by three, okay? And use lots of bow for that. So you're not playing it with, you know, but use a healthy tone. I tell my students to really play with a healthy sound, with a good bowing, for two reasons. First of all, you can hear if you are out of tune better, because if you've got this resonant sound, if you got it full tone, it's way easier to hear if you're a little bit off than that you're playing, yeah, very unclear, like a, and very vaguely and bit shifting your fingers around. And also the second reason is, well, we all think practice makes perfect. Well, sadly, it doesn't. It just makes permanent. So if you use bad bowing for quite a while because you're focusing on the intonation, then that's the bowing that you will remember and that you will do when you're playing other pieces. So be really careful with that. And just practice it in such a tempo, so slow, so you can really give attention to all those details. If you feel overwhelmed and you're thinking like, oh, my intonation is off and my bowing is off, then just move to one bow stroke per note and just play that note until you're satisfied with the intonation as well as the bowing. Resonant, and it doesn't matter how much time that costs. Even if you play, a normal way to study etudes, for example, is that you play just one line to begin with and then study the second line, try to connect them and then go on like that. Eventually, and this can take some weeks, okay? It can even take you some months. This etude is definitely not easy, and I even have advanced violinists kind of grabbing these Wolfhard etudes again to deepen their skills even more, okay? So you can go on with this as long as you like, actually. If you play it with the original bowing, you want to get that fluency. And if people think about fluent playing, they often think about the right hand, about the bow. Of course, here that is very important. A couple of things. You need to have a consistent sound, a consistent bow speed, so not do... You need to play the notes very rhythmically and really divide your bow in six parts. And while you are doing this, it can help to give the last notes a little bit more bow, because people always have the tendency to play. So to correct this, you can play, and that gives you that gives you that feeling of that the music is continuing. So that's a little trick, by the way, to give the last notes under a slur a little bit more bow. And when you want to play something fluently, you might not think about a left hand. Well, it's so important. You want to do two things in this etude. What you want to do is leave the fingers as much as possible on the string. At least leave the previous note on the string, okay? And that's a perfect way to get some stability in your intonation. The second tip is to leave your fingers as much as possible above the string. And it shouldn't be very forced and tensed, but just keep them close. The further you go away with your fingers, the higher the risk on out of tune notes. Third tip I would like to give you is to prepare the next note. So you see, when I play this A, the B is already coming. And for example, in a... then my B, the first finger, is already above the A string. And just when I need to put it down, it really goes down, but before that it's already moving in that direction. You see, I leave the fingers on the string. When I go back, then they are already there. In that long note, I can already place my first finger there on that F sharp. You see, so that's the principle of preparation of your fingers. And it really helps your intonation a lot. And it helps your fluency a lot. So it's really useful to do that. Then I want to point out some things in this etude that might be a little bit tricky. Now, all jumps can be tricky. So going from the 1 to the 4, and then the triad here, and of course something like this in the second line. Then you move with your fingers from the A string to the D string, then the G string, and then you have to make sure that, you know, sometimes it can feel, because you have to go over the other strings, that you have to play higher on the G string. And that is not true, of course, but as your fingers need to reach a bit further, it can seem that way. So be aware of that and make sure that you're not going to play lower on the lower strings if you are coming from higher strings, because that's something that really a lot of people do. So when we continue in there in the third bar of line 2, I'll just forward it a bit. And then we have this G sharp you need to look out for. This is also something that a lot of people play out of tune. Mind that high third finger there for the G sharp. And then also, if you move from that D to the A and then to the E, it's the other way around. So maybe for your feeling, you have to play lower. It's not true, but it can feel that way. So make sure you're in tune. Then we have something tricky. It's a B. And then we place the A sharp right under that B, okay? So they're really close together. So make sure you are curving your pinky a little bit so you can put that high third finger already underneath it, and then it gets trickier because we have to move all the way to a G. So we have to move from a high third finger to a low second finger. That's a big distance, okay? And as I told you to stick the fingers to the string as much as possible, here I recommend lifting that third finger before you put down that low second finger, because otherwise you're going to play a G sharp-ish, for example. So spend a lot of time on the intonation of this to make it more difficult. You also had in the bar between that G sharp, so you have to be clearly play a G sharp there. All right, well, let's go to line 4 then. Again, everywhere we're going over the strings like that, don't make your string crossings too large, of course. Keep them close together, prepare them well, so that if you see that you have to move to the D string, already move your arm a little bit in the direction of that and the other way around. It can be really tricky there, certainly to get that on the E string right. Low second finger. And that can feel like you are putting the second finger on the place of the first finger, because you are coming from high second fingers on the D and the A string, and then on the E string you suddenly have a low second finger that is low and feels even lower, because you're coming from lower strings, okay? Also a tricky one, we have here that C sharp high third finger. So try it, needs to be in tune. And then we have a G, so a normal third finger. And then, in the last line, we then again have that high third finger on the D sharp. So this is really tricky for the intonation. Uh, So it not only changes that third finger from high to low, and you might not even be used to the high third finger, and we are doing that over all strings. So really spend some time practicing this. And if you're practicing, sometimes just start with last line, okay? So don't play it all the time from line one to the end. Start with the last line, because it's quite tricky actually. And then we have an octave, so A, A. Make sure that it's the same as the open A string. And then, if you can do a double stop, then do that. Because this really must be into tune. So that's how you kind of shift around with that until you got it. But of course, you must practice it until you can get it in one go, all right? Well, that's it. Really take your time for this etude. Give yourself time. And even if you've started practicing the reading concerto that we're going to learn from next week, keep playing this etude, and also of course keep playing that B minor 2 octave scale that we've learned in last lesson, because that will really help you prepare for this beautiful concerto that will start next week. Will you be there? I really hope so. So subscribe to my channel and turn on notifications so you will be one of the first to know when that lesson goes live. I hope to see you next week. Bye bye.